Jay Onrait, presented by McDonald's. That's the television program that you are tuning into. We are grateful that you did. And a big, big matchup Monday night in the National Hockey League between the best team in the NHL, the Toronto Maple Leafs, trying to set a new franchise record for the best start for 20 games to start a season. It's hard to figure out how to say that properly. Calgary's struggling, though. Calgary's lost three straight. They've been outscored 14-3 in the process. Both teams starting their backups because of injuries to their starters. Michael Hutchinson starting in place of Freddie Anderson, who once again is out with that lower body injury. And here's Sam Bennett is going to beat Hutchinson. Bennett looking for a trade, helping his trade value. Right place, right time. 1-0 Calgary. It's a year ago Monday. David Ayers, friend of Sports Center with Jay Onrait, beat the Leafs as an emergency goalie for the Carolina Hurricanes. This is Ayers' personal display. What a moment. What a time in our lives. Calgary, they start their backup David Rittich because Jake Markstrom is out with an upper body injury. Leafs on the power play later in the first. Morgan Riley, former Moose Jaw Warriors star, off the crossbar, and then Rittich denies John Tavares in tight.
Leafs are looking at it.
We're going to the second period, and Calgary's on the man advantage. By the way, how beautiful are these Calgary uniforms? This is a good uniform matchup. Two good uniforms. Matthew Tkachuk, so frustrated after that loss to Edmonton on Saturday, snaps a 9-game goalless drought and reaches career goal number 100. So it's 2-0 Calgary, but then the Flames take a pair of quick penalties, and that would give Toronto a 5-on-3 for over a minute and a half. Matthews, William Nylander, in tight, denied by Rittich. So that'll give Leaf Nation something to complain about again, even though they are the best team in the NHL. Got to talk about Nylander. Third period, about a minute in. Leafs odd man rush. Alexander Barabanov.
Matthews flips that wide.
Off the crossbar. Minutes later. Flames back on the man advantage, and it would be exciting, exhilarating. Sean Monahan snapping a 12-game goalless drought. Calgary is up 3-0. Austin Matthews, 16 consecutive games with a point. That is too shy of the Leafs record, held by Daryl Sittler and Eddie Olczyk.
Stolen now by Marner, a centering pass in the feet of Kerfoot. Marner
brings it off the post. Matthews' streak comes to an end. David Rittich, first Flames goalie to earn a shutout in Toronto since the franchise relocated from Atlanta to Calgary in 1980. Austin Matthews on why the Leafs lost.
We didn't really have a lot of jump to start the game with, and you know, obviously they played very desperate tonight. You know, things haven't probably haven't really been going the way that they wanted to lately, and they definitely came out with a purpose tonight. And you know, we didn't really have any pushback.
Your own personal little scoring streak came to an end. Any thoughts on that?
Yeah, I mean, it's could really care less to talk about that, to be honest.
We still have some ground to make up, and just starts with one though. Hopefully, we can get rolling here, and we know they're going to come out very hard next game. Nobody likes it in shutout, especially in their home building. So we're going to be and enjoy this one tonight for a little bit.
Hey, you saw Matthew Tkachuk right there. He joins Matthews and Patty Laine as the only players from the 2016 draft to reach 100 goals. His milestone goal comes in his 312th career game. His dad, Keith Tkachuk, took 73 fewer games to reach that mark, and he will definitely let his son know about that. But at 23 years, 73 days, Matthew eclipses Pops as the youngest member of the family at the time of his 100th goal. And by the way, Brady's 21 and currently sits at 49 goals. Wouldn't it be great to have Jeff on every night? The former Carolina Hurricane, Jeff O'Neill. Lightning taking on the Canes. Lightning were shut out in each of their first two matchups with the Canes this season. Canes come in having won two straight and 5 of 6. James Reimer all over the crease here. Rhyme time. Desperation saves. Carolina up 1-0 after one. Second period, Lightning on the power play. They're working it around. It's Hedman to Stamkos. And that's music to the ears of Bolts fans. Hedman to Stamkos. We're tied. Second period, 13 to go. Hedman, oh, he's so good.
Stamkos went to the draw. Sergachev high slot. Left circle to Hedman. Score! Hedman!
Yeah, Victor Hedman giving Tampa the lead with his fourth of the season. Hedman and Stamkos, a goal and an assist. Lightning take it 4-2. Well, Dallas Stars playing their first game in 9 days. They had four home games postponed because of that weather in Texas. All of that after their coronavirus outbreak and training camp delayed the start of their season. So after an excellent season in the bubble, tough start for the Stars. And here's Jamie Benn taking a shot to the testicles.
Yeah, that's the danger.
He'd be okay. But then linesman Devin Berg also takes a shot to the testicles.
He was attempting to get the puck
Berg
deep and
had to leave this game.
Now the linesman,
so they're down to two refs and one Berg linesman. I wonder if they would have gone with one ref and then had one of the refs be a linesman just like the old days. I didn't look into it. Late in the frame, tied at one, Keith Yandle. Point shot beats Anton Khudobin. Florida franchise record 29 shots in the second. They had 51 shots. Panthers win their 6th and 8th game. Stars have lost 6 in a row. Buffalo, New York Islanders, the Patty LaFontaine Cup. Jeff Skinner, healthy scratch. One assist in 14 games. Year two of an 8-year deal worth $9 million a season. Casey Mittelstadt replaced him in the lineup. Matthew Barzell, you're not scratching this guy. He stopped there, back check, takes it away from Lazar, keeps it in, works it around, and eventually it'll come back to friend of SportsCenter with Jay Onrait, Jordan Eberle. Nice little touch pass to the captain, Anders Lee. And it's all started by Matthew Barzell. Incredible. Sabres down 2-1 in the third on the power play. Sam Reinhart,
38 parked in front. Power play. Don't lean again.
And watch the hand die. Not only does he bat it out of the air, he flips the blade to make contact. That's brilliant stuff. That's an athlete. We're tied at 2, 5 minutes to go. Still 2-2. Nick Leddy, point shot. That stopped J.G. Pageau with the game winner. New York's won all three meetings with Buffalo this season. Artemi Panarin has taken a leave of absence from the Rangers after a Russian newspaper report alleged he got into an altercation with an 18-year-old woman 10 years ago. Panarin has been publicly critical of Russian President Vladimir Putin, who the team believes could be behind the story. In fact, they released this statement which said Artemi vehemently and unequivocally denies any and all allegations in this fabricated story. This is clearly an intimidation tactic being used against him for being outspoken on recent political events. Artemi is obviously shaken and concerned and will take some time away from the team. The Rangers fully support Artemi and will work with them to identify the source of these unfounded allegations with more. Here's Rod Smith.
Now joined by Isabel Kershudian, Washington Post foreign correspondent in Moscow. Isabel, what more can you tell us about how the story emerged?
Yeah, I think the big thing to look into is obviously the timing. This is coming on the heels of, you know, Panarin putting out an Instagram message in support of Alexei Navalny, you know, the main kind of Russian opposition figure here, who was poisoned in August by, you know, what he says was a state-ordered attack. He recovered in Germany and then, you know, returned in January and was immediately jailed upon his return to Russia. So, you know, it's been a kind of heated time in Russia right now, a lot of political tension and discontent over how Navalny's been treated. And, you know, Panarin even putting just an Instagram post saying freedom for Navalny is making quite a political statement. So I don't think that Andrei Nazarov, you know, talking to a pro-Kremlin media outlet right now about, you know, something that purportedly happened 10 years ago is a coincidence.
Yeah, I want to follow up on that from what the Rangers said in their statement. They say, quote, this is clearly an intimidation tactic being used against Panarin for being outspoken on recent political events. That's in their statement. So, yeah, what do you make of this story?
Yeah, I think there's, you know, some nuance here, right? It's a leap to say that this was Kremlin orchestrated, but I do think it has to do with his political views, certainly. I don't think Nazarov comes out with this story that has, you know, a lot of pretty outrageous details, including, you know, a 40,000 euro cash payment to Latvian police, as if it's that easy to take out 40,000 euros in cash at a random Latvian bank. You know, I don't think that comes out if, you know, Artemi hadn't been public in his political views. But I also don't know if it's fair to say at this point, based on what we know, that you know, someone from the Kremlin called up Nazarov and told him to talk about this. It's entirely possible that Nazarov has his own vendetta against Panarin, or just doesn't like his political views and kind of came out with this on his own. But I do think Panarin's being targeted for, you know, what he said about Navalny and what he previously said about Putin. You know, as far as this story goes, I don't think people found it entirely convincing or credible, but it's entirely possible that because he's been politically outspoken and he has said things about Putin in a past interview in 2019, that he kind of sees this as sort of an indicator of other threats. That, you know, maybe he's worried about his family who still lives here. Maybe he thinks that there's more to come, you know, stories like this, or maybe other things that he's worried about because he's been politically outspoken. And certainly, you know, that's not unheard of in Russia for there to be kind of, you know, retribution or response to kind of voicing your political beliefs.
How common is it for athletes to speak out against Russian leadership?
Yeah, it's super rare. I mean, I think it's more common for, you know, you've seen players like Ovechkin and even Malkin, you know, come out and support Putin. Ovechkin even kind of a couple of years ago started what he called the Putin team ahead of, you know, the 2018 presidential elections. So that's sort of par for the course. You know, it's incredibly rare for someone of Panarin's status, arguably the best Russian player in hockey, to kind of say what he has. I think back to an interview he did 2 years ago when, you know, he said the mistake that Russians make is treating Putin like he's superhuman, that, you know, there are alternatives to him. And so I think that's kind of when it started for him, when he kind of got on the radar as, you know, maybe someone who was finding his political voice, and this was kind of a continuation of that.
Isabel Kershudian of the Washington Post, thank you for this.
Thank you.
Wow, that was terrific from Isabel. Still to come, just days after an eight-hour delay, the Avs and Golden Knights move indoors, where Colorado looks for a third straight win. You're watching SportsCenter with Jay Onrait, brought to you by McDonald's on TSN, Canada's sports leader. Watching SportsCenter with Jay Onrait. A television program about sports. Marc-Andre Fleury, seventh straight start. They wanted to trade him in the offseason. They signed Robin Leonard. Fleury's just played so good, they can't keep him out of the lineup. And there robs Nathan MacKinnon after losing his stick. Incredible later. Fleury, the windmill to rob Nazem Kadri. Yes, the Avs in the reverse retros. The Quebec Nordique jerseys, beautiful, scoreless after one. Vegas power play in the second. William Karlsson to Alex Tuch. Nicely done. Beats Philip Grubauer for a sixth. 3 minutes later, Tuck centers it. Puck goes off. Bowen Byram skating in. Tuck gets credit for a second of the game. First multi-goal game since December the 2nd, 2019. Now 3-0 in the third. Nazem Kadri gets another chance. Fleury, though, yeah, while lying on his back, denies Kadri right there. See another one. A few shifts later, Fleury. One, two, three big saves. He stopped all 34 shots he faced. Third shutout in 11 games this season. 64th of his career. He's tied with Henrik Lundqvist for 16th all time. Ducks and Yotes, Trevor Zegras, U.S. captain at the World Juniors, NHL debut, ninth overall, 2019. He had to scramble a suit together for the big game.
I got Jamie Drysdale's, I got his coat, so it's kind of a makeshift suit. Coming from the World Juniors, I didn't really have time to pack or plan or anything, so kind of just make it up as we go here.
Okay. First period. World Juniors is like a month and a half ago. Someone couldn't have like FedExed them a suit. It's like a long time, but okay, Zegras, great chance here. Jakob Silverberg was impressed with the youngster at intermission.
Good sequence, unfortunately. Raquel doesn't get a good piece of that.
He's awfully good with that puck, so it's fun. It's fun watching him. I think him coming in brings a lot of energy to the team, and like we said, we had a terrific period, and I think he's a big part of it.
And just to clarify, Zegras passing to Ricard Raquel on that last highlight, and then final minute, Zegras, a great chance here. John Gibson
What a big stop there by Darcy.
No, that's not John Gibson. That would be Darcy Kuemper denying him because John Gibson is on his own team. So two shots, just over 13 minutes of ice time. How are things going for the Lakers without Anthony Davis?
Not that good.
I would have to agree. The defending champs are reeling without AD in the lineup. They barely beat the Timberwolves, and since then they've lost two straight to the Nets and the Heat. Would their luck change against the Wizards? The Lakers broadcast had Isaiah Thomas instead of Russell Westbrook in their starting lineup. Not the Hall of Famer Isaiah Thomas, a different Isaiah Thomas. Thomas played for the Wizards last season. Well, Russ was in the game, and Russell Westbrook is so fast. A few minutes later, finds NBA scoring leader Bradley Beal. Boy, these guys are a great combo. Westbrook, 13 points, 4 assists in the first half. But here comes the King, threading the needle to Kentavious Caldwell-Pope. And then a minute later, two of his 18 to go with 10 dimes. Through three, Lakers though down two to the Wizards. Memphis was blown out by 31 on Saturday. Their struggles continue on Monday against the Mavs. Grayson Allen, who looks like Ted Cruz, as if that's not a big enough problem in his life, passes it off the head of Maxi Kleber. Luka Doncic, not faring much better.
Not enough time. Doncic for three.
Yeah.
In and out.
7 points in the first half. That's not good for him.
We talked about first quarter.
But he would recover. First, distributing. The lob to Dwight Powell, who is
Doncic starting
Canadian. One of 5 assists for Luka. And then Doncic wearing the Jim Jackson, Jamal Mashburn, Jason Kidd throwbacks, which I quite like. And then miss three.
Doncic.
Finally, Luka smiles. Second most famous person from Slovenia after Anže Kopitar. Shea Gilgeous-Alexander, good Hamilton guy, coming off a 31-point night against the Cavs Sunday. His Thunder hosting Miami. Canadian looking good early. Look at the moves. Gets it to go. SGA, 10 of Oklahoma City's 21 first-quarter points. He's been averaging just under 26 points in his last 5 games. Hits the 3 there. Finished with 27. He's just 22 years old. Canada basketball in good hands. Kendrick Nunn to Bam Adebayo. Bam, 19 points, 13 boards. Third straight double-double. Heat overcome a 9-point differential at the half. Managed to win their third straight. 108-94 the final. Portland, the city where young people go to retire, against Phoenix, the city where old people go to retire. Devin Booker has scored at least 20 points in 7 consecutive games. He's also dating Kendall Jenner. So life's pretty good for that dude. 17 in the first quarter, second quarter. Look at that move. Oh, yes. Absorbs the contact, draws the foul. Phoenix came in winners of 8 of their last 9. Final seconds of the second quarter, Booker on the baseline. He led all scorers with 22 in the first half. Booker also the spinoff of 21 Jump Street, starring Richard Grieco. Probably the best series of the 20th century. Suns by 9 at the break. Booker one-on-one with Damian Lillard. Step back 3. Booker needed just 3 quarters to finish with a game-high 34 points as the Suns beat Portlandia.
Covington heaves it down the floor.
Zach LaVine, you know he's a great dunker, 2-time dunk champion, but this year he has turned into an all-around great player for the Chicago Bulls, averaging nearly 29 points a game this season, making a strong case to be an all-star reserve. The all-star reserves will be named today, as in Tuesday. LaVine for 3 from the corner. Nice pass from Thaddeus Young there. And LaVine finishes with the left hand. He reached 20-plus points in 17 straight games. Yeah, LaVine ended up scoring 11 straight Bulls points in just a minute and a half of game time. Finished with 21. You got to believe he's going to be on the All-Star team. His Bulls get the win over the Rockets. Jay Onrait program, the source for all your curling needs. Draw 8 Scotties. Jennifer Jones needs just one more win to pass Colleen Jones for most Scotties wins all time, which is shocking to Lindsay. taking on Sherry Anderson's Saskatchewan rink. Shout out to Scotty Jenkins. Seventh end tied at two. Jones last without Hammer.
Can you get it off of that when you did?
And
to it.
The six-time Scotty's champ taps the redstone back far enough, led to a steal of one for Manitoba. They're up 3-2. 10th end Manitoba still up one. Jones last without Hammer. She's facing two. Runs the yellow back, can't push the red far enough. And Saskatchewan's going to hold on to take it 5-4.
Thanks for the game.
How about draw nine? Last year, Team Alberta skipped by Laura Walker lost four straight after starting 3-0. They're coming off a loss to the Rachel Holman rink from Ontario after opening with three straight wins, facing Beth Peterson and her wild card rink. Eighth end, Alberta down 4-3. Walker with Hammer needs a bit of the four. And a nice shot by the skip. Back and forth we go. Alberta ties it up at four. She looks shocked that she made that. 10th in. Wild card rink on top by one. Peterson's last without Hammer. And this was not good. Peterson obviously frustrated. To Walker's last. The hit and stick for the win.
Rochelle Brown trying to find that hole. Get off that yellow, get by that red. No, crash, bang, and it will, no, it'll be a steal.
Vic's call, pretty amazing. Peterson's rink steals. Team Alberta and Walker drop a second straight game. Monday was the first full team workout for the Toronto Blue Jays at their spring training facility in Dunedin. Bo Bichette was there after an offseason where Toronto appeared to kick tires on other shortstops, including Cleveland star Francisco Lindor, who ended up with the Mets. Bichette says there's no need to keep searching. He's ready to be the guy.
For me, I mean, obviously I've told you guys a bunch of times I want to be a shortstop. I think that I can be a really good one. And, you know, I'm going to put the work in to be. So, you know, for me this offseason I heard the rumors, but really it was just all about continue to work as much as I can at shortstop. Last year took a toll on everybody, and I think that I didn't handle it as best as some of the guys around the league did. So for me, it's about learning from that and not making the same mistake. You know, I look at it, if I put the work in and I'm consistent every single day and make sure, like I said, I'm prepared and I play hard, it'll all work itself out. So for me, this year's about being consistent with my work, you know, and I think it that should handle it.
All right, so it's a small sample size, but our stats guy, Hound Dog Harrison, put together this. Bo Bichette's numbers in his first 75 career games put him on pace for over 200 hits, 58 doubles, 35 home runs over 162 games. Seattle Mariners president and CEO Kevin Mather resigned Monday following a month of backlash over disparaging comments he made to a Rotary Club about several current and former Mariner players. Major League Baseball commented on it. Mariners chairman and managing partner John Stanton said Mather's comments were inappropriate, do not represent our organization's feeling about our players, staff, and fans. I sincerely apologize on behalf of the club and my partners to our players and fans. We must be and do better. We have a lot of work to do to make amends, and that work is already underway. When we return, we've got a new name for the Jannies again. And it's not on rights and wrongs.
It's the one-year anniversary since former Zamboni driver David Ayers came in for Carolina and beat the Toronto Maple Leafs. So we ask you this hypothetical. If it were to happen tonight and TSNers were the only option, you have to pick one of these between the pipes. No Jamie McLennan. You can't do that. Ex-NHLer Jeff O'Neill, ex-Olympian Tessa Bonhomme, ex-netminder in his day Gino Retta, or 6'6" desk jockey Jay Onrait. Who do you like? Oh.
Jay Onrait. I'm going on a show later this evening, so I had to pick him, but I just think at 6'6", and I think he's weird enough to go in. Look at that. There's weird enough right there. 6'6", he would go in the net.
See, I thought this was a real question, so I'm going to provide a real answer, and that's Jay Onrait, for the same reason that O-Dog just talked about. I mean, you're talking about size and wingspan. I mean, Jay Onrait is what, 6'6"? I mean, that's what he is. Gino Retta would be great in lacrosse because he'd cover the whole net. But in this case, Jay Onrait is your prototypical NHL starting goal.
Jay would give up 30 goals on 22 shots.
I'm still laughing at the Geno line. Oh, man, guys, I love it. The quiz is still fun. Tuesday, the Habs take on the Senators. Viewers in the Habs region can watch Molson export Canadiens hockey at 7 local, 8 Atlantic. And viewers in the Sens region can watch Canadian Tire Sens hockey, 7 in the nation's capital, 8 Atlantic. Coming off that 3-2 OT win for the Sens on Sunday. Today's suggestion for a replacement name for the Jannies comes from viewer Jason Walmark. And it reminds me of those delicious mint chocolate sticks you get around the holidays. It's Onrait's Ovations, and it begins with NCAA hockey. A late, so see something not very, they make a late goalie change as if they were coming out as a line change. I don't know if I've ever seen that before. Stars, Panthers, Dallas power play, Rupe hints, shot on net, Jamie Benn takes a shot in the testicles. We showed you this earlier. Jamie Benn, the dangers when you're captain of your Dallas Stars. Florida got the victory. Florida is just rolling this year. NCAA soccer, Columbus State's Olivia Roth dangling between two defenders, and then the unbelievable shot that ends up in the net. Wow. Olivia. Okay, we see you, Olivia Roth. Near the end of the first period, Nazem Kadri appears to have a wide open cage. But Marc-Andre Fleury has been so good this season. Shut out in this one. I believe it was his third of the season already. G League Hoops. Oklahoma City Blue taking on the Iowa Wolves. Oh, that was nice. It's Alexei Kukushevsky saving it from going out of bounds, getting it to Moses Brown for the layup. Very nice. Sabres Isles, Linus Ullmark. He's beaten by Anders Lee. Yeah, he plays the puck behind the net, gets it to the Sabres, and a nice touch pass there from Jordan Eberle, who did not invite us to his wedding. Hornets and Jazz, Rudy Gobert. And this guy has been a monster defensively for the Jazz this season. Look at that, two big blocks. I'm thinking he's going to be named to the All-Star reserves today. That'll be later today. That'll happen. And Morgan Rielly, that shot. John Tavares trying to put away the rebound. Dave Riddick with the shutout for the Calgary Flames to beat Toronto 3-0 and keep Toronto from having their best 20-game start to a season ever. The Leafs are still 14-2-2 or something like that. Okay, we're going to take a break. And when we come back, we've got the highlight of the night and all the things I messed up, which is plenty. It's the worst play of the day.
That's a heavy
Eric Chernak, Jesper Fath, collide.
He ends up in the Hurricanes
Chernak
bench.
Ends up in the Hurricanes bench. Chernak, 6'3", 230 pounds. That almost 40 pounds heavier than Fath. Highlight of the night, back to Long Island. Well, I'm glad this is the highlight of the night. I think this is the correct choice. Sam Reinhart in front. Bats it out of midair. This will probably lead to the top 10 batting out of midair goals in another top 10 on Tuesday. But the key here is he flips the blade to make contact. Awesome. Okay, you blew it's our segment where I point out all the things I messed up. I said O-Dog was turning 46. He's actually turning 45 today. So happy birthday, O-Dog. Thanks for being on the show. I messed up. I said the Blues lost Monday because of their awful uniforms. Turns out they lost because the Kings scored more goals than they did. And I also said Trevor Zegras was stopped by John Gibson during the Ducks highlights. John Gibson, Trevor Zegras both play for the Ducks. Darcy Kemper stopped Zegras. And the Leafs 14-4-2, not 14-2-2. That doesn't add up to 20. See ya.
Quiet on the set, please.